Tonight we're speaking with Emily Warren, who just a matter of days ago won a Grammy Award.
I know.
For her work with the Chainsmokers, and has collaborated with many other incredible musicians such as Shawn Mendes and Friendship. And tomorrow night we're going to be speaking with James Newman, who has been collaborating with artists like Rudimental and who won a Brit Award for his work with Rudimental, with David Guetta, with Calvin Harris and other extraordinary people as well. So we're unbelievably fortunate to have this kind of level of experience and perspective from this enormous global industry that we in New Zealand are connected to by the internet, but in many ways find it hard to connect to physically because we're so geographically distant from it. And so part of the whole purpose of Songhubs, apart from writing songs, which are the all-important thing and the generator of all of this and the reason that all of us are here, there's also that kind of amazing and beautiful side effect of creating communities, creative relationships, and especially building that sense of collaborative possibility, because we are very much a country of individualists, and as we were kind of talking about a little bit last night with Mike, we find it hard to draw that line between artist and writer. You know, for us, those things are the same. You don't, you know, Neil Finn didn't collaborate with somebody on Don't Dream It's Over. He wrote that song by himself, and we all kind of think that's what people should do. They should write things by themselves, otherwise, you know, maybe it's a diluted process. But actually, most of the world's music, especially the music that everyone's listening to right now, is written collaboratively. And there's an incredible richness and diversity of ideas and thoughts and influences that you open yourself up to when you start collaborating with people. You know, perspectives and ideas and musical thoughts that you would never have imagined on your own suddenly become part of your work and part of your own language too. And then you in turn share that with the people that you're collaborating with. So that's really what Songhubs is all about. Now, tonight, oh, I should actually also tell you who I am. Back to me. My name is Victoria Kelly. I'm the Director of Member Services at APRA AMCOS, and I work with an incredible team of people, all of whom have kind of helped to put this all together and worked passionately to make it all happen. But I also have a background in music. I'm a composer. I've written film soundtracks and I've played in lots of bands. I played in SJD for a long time. I collaborate a lot with bands and do orchestral and string arrangements for them. Work a lot with Neil Finn, tour with them sometimes. So I've had a 25-year background in the music industry myself, and now I'm at the industry end of it. And kind of seeing this incredible landscape of 10,000 APRA members, you know, 10,000 people in this country who have signed up and said, I write songs and I write music, and helping those people to connect to each other, to understand how they can earn royalties from what they do. That's my story. But we're here to talk to Emily, and I think that what's fascinating about Emily is that she is a very rare creature in the context of the music industry, which is made up of a vastly disproportionate number of men. And I want to say right from the outset that the fact that we're going to talk a little bit about inequality in the music industry is in no way a negative sentiment towards men. I want to make that really clear. Music, as another songwriter that I was talking about earlier today, is a human experience. Benny, thank you very much for that. It's a human experience. It's something that resonates with all of us. 50% of the audience for music is female, and the other 50% is male. And yet, of our members, only 21% are women. In England, in PRS, only 13% of songwriters are women. In Australia, of all of the international live acts that get programmed, only 14% are women. Women are massively underrepresented on boards and in music industry, senior management and director positions throughout the industry. And so we have this situation where a 24-year-old woman wins a Grammy and finds her way in an industry which is very heavily geared towards a male experience of the human condition. And I think that that's a really interesting thing for us to explore, because the world must look very interesting to you as you walk from room to room. If you go by those percentages, at least 79% of the people you work with are men. So maybe we'll get to that a little bit further down this track, because I think probably the first thing I should ask you and the first thing we should talk about is how you started. You know, what was the beginning and what kind of led you down the road in just 4 short years, you know, of your career from starting to the Grammys?
Thank you for that intro. Also, first of all, thank you all so much for coming. I'm honestly flattered that you're here to hear me speak about all of this. I started off writing songs when I was probably 11 or 12 years old, and it was nothing good at the time at all, but just kind of like, it was an urge for me. I was going to middle school at the time, and like something would happen, some drama or something, and I would need to go home and write a song about it in order to like be okay with what had just happened. So it started as really just an outlet for me. And my dad actually one day was like, we should try and get some of these songs recorded. And that's kind of how the ball started rolling. And I put a band together by the time I was in high school. And we played kind of like around New York City for a few years while I was in high school. And then when I went off to college, the band split up, and I was really like, all right, now I went to this music school and everyone was really like had their shit together. And we got there, I was like, my band just split up, I have no idea what I'm doing, but like I'm gonna show up to class and be like, I'm the best. But so after maybe like halfway through my first year, I was set up on a session with this guy named Scott Harris. It was my first collaborative session ever, and I was basically forced into it by this guy who was managing me at the time. And he was like, have you ever thought about being a songwriter? And I was like, hell no, I'll never write songs for other people. Like, that's completely defeating the purpose of what I'm doing. And I went to the session, I didn't say a word the whole time. I was pissed that I was there. And really, I didn't. And somehow, the next day, Scott, who I was writing with, called me and was like, are you free today? Like, just come by the studio again. Like, let's try again. And I want you to sing something. So I went back, I sang something for him, and then we ended up writing a song, and it was like so amazing for me for a second to like not change what I was doing, but to kind of like throw an idea out into the room and have someone else say, oh, well, what if you did this? And just kind of like expand on what I was doing, which in my head was not like I thought I was gonna go in, and he's gonna be like, you need to say this and you need to do this. And it was instead very like two minds working on one thing, which is just better, I think. We started writing. I ended up, everything kind of happened magically. I met my manager, Zach, through Scott, who was my first session. We've been together since like the very, very beginning. And I also at the time was, I went through my emails one day and I was like, do I know anybody at any record label or any publishing company or anything that I can send these 5 songs I've written to? And I typed in records, and an email, Rhea at Atlantic Records, came up, and she had been an intern who came to see my band play one time, and like we had an email exchange where she was like, this needs work, but it's promising or something. So I emailed her and I was like, I know this is crazy, but I'm starting to write like just for pitch, and can I come in and meet with you at Atlantic Records? And she responded almost immediately saying, I was in New York at the time, and she responded saying, I actually just moved to LA, and tomorrow I'm switching jobs. I'm moving from Atlantic Records to Dr. Luke's Prescription Songs Publishing Company, which was just starting kind of at the time. And I was like, how is this happening? And she kept saying, oh, I'm going to play your stuff for Luke. And I was like, no, you're not. And she did. And one night texted me at like 2 a.m, check your Facebook messages. And I was like, what's happening? And I opened my messages, and it was from Dr. Luke saying, I've listened to your music, it's great, like I'd love to help out in any way. And I was like, and maybe a month later, I like saved up money and I flew to LA to meet him and kind of work with his people, which was a really daunting but cool experience where he like put me in with his writers, which I knew was a test, and like showing up to a session being like, everyone's gonna like call Luke after this and tell him what they think of me was really scary, but good, really good, like boot camp. And then I signed pretty much like a few months later and ended up splitting my time while I was in college between New York and LA and just like graduating as quick as I could. and spent maybe a year living out in LA and just kind of like doing every possible session I could do, like 7 days a week, two sessions a day, which I will never do again, Zach. and it was amazing, and I learned so much, I think, from going from being someone who just writes songs in your bedroom or just writes because you have to going into rooms and knowing, all right, you have 6-7 hours to like finish a song and it needs to be like tight pop lyric and like you need to get the whole thing in and you have this day and you have to do it in front of a stranger was just like a crazy learning experience. And in LA, there's a lot of like, especially in Luke's camp and like Max Martin's camp, they have a lot of rules of like, okay, this is how many syllables can be in this part, and this is where this note, like the chorus note should always be higher than the pre and should always be higher than the verse, so the song's building. And I spent a year like learning that. And then when I left, kind of like putting that all in the back burner, but it was just a good, these are things you don't think about when you're just like, I'm sad.
Yeah, did that kind of prescription,
yeah,
sorry about the pun, did that kind of interfere or argue with your ideals about what a musical process was or should be? Like when you're in a commercial environment and you're writing something that essentially, the way that you've described it, it sounds pretty mercenary. How do you kind of align that commercial drive with actually what is essentially a very personal and introspective process? Like how do you externalize that and then kind of put it out there knowing that you're also having to fit into something very specific?
Yeah, that's a hard one. I think for a while I was kind of compromising my own writing, not fully, but just like really wanting to just learn. I mean, at the time it was like Kesha and Katy Perry and all those songs were the top of the charts, and it was like you'd hear Teenage Dream and be like, okay, I could never write something like this. Like, I just couldn't. That's amazing. And it's like pop and the lyrics are kind of silly, but like, it's exactly what you want to hear. So it was kind of like the simpler it is, the more, like, that's so impressive to me to kind of like take an essay's worth of emotion in your head and put it into like really small, simple, easy to sing along to lines. It's like an art form. That's amazing. So for a while, to be totally honest, like for that year, I was really just like, I'd go to a session with an idea in my head, like, all right, I'm gonna write a song called Door today and just figure out how that makes sense and like figure out what rhymes with that and just like how to build a story around that. And then something, after that year, something really unlocked for me. I was in a session with this band that was these two twin girls, and I'm a twin too, so it was like, they're an artist and band. And I kind of felt like, all right, there's something really interesting with these two girls who are, they're fraternal twins, they don't look the same, they both like have their own different thing, and they've been put into this band together, and their label's like playing off the fact that they're twins and all this stuff. I was like, I need to talk to them about what this is feeling like. And we spent like I was there for a week working with them, and we spent the first like almost entire day just talking about it, talking about their dad was managing them and what that meant and their relationship with each other. And then I watched them like admit stuff to each other about how they felt with this whole thing. And I was like, oh my God, there's 900 songs here. Like, this is easy now. And that was a really cool moment for me too, because it was kind of like bringing back my old way and applying these new tricks I had learned, but knowing that like, okay, songs are still supposed to be about the truth. Like, songs are still like an expression of you, ideally. Like, if you write a song, the perfect recipe is you're telling the truth, you're being honest, and you're putting it in a way that's simple enough that a million people can hear it and say, oh my God, I feel the same exact way. And I can sing along to that, and it can come on in the club, and I'll be like, yeah, it's my song. And that is tricky, but that's what's fun to me about writing songs. It's like, because I'm sure everyone in this room has heard a song before where you put it on, and it's like, how does this person know what I'm going through right now? like reading my diary in a song, and that is what gives me the chills and what kind of music I want to try and make. And so to make it accessible and true is like sweet spot.
That's fascinating, because, so again, it's that human experience, it's that truthful experience. And just to kind of touch on the kind of female-male inequality thing for a second, when 79% of songwriters are men and 50% of the audience at least are women, does that not somehow suggest that it is men who are telling women the truth about themselves? And indeed, is that the truth? Like, do you find it's harder or different? What's your experience of collaborating with men versus collaborating with women? And what different things are brought out for different people when you do that?
Yeah, we've talked a little bit about this. I think that I can think of a lot of examples that I won't say, but like,
come on.
I couldn't.
Would you like a drink?
you know what I'll say if you do that. There's songs, particularly in pop, and wait, I gotta back up a second actually, because I have an idea of how I'm gonna explain this. I went maybe last year, maybe a year and a half ago, to the Jay-Z and Beyonce tour. Did anyone here see that tour? They didn't come to New Zealand, that's fucked up. But anyways.
We're a long way away.
It's not cool. It was crazy to me. I mean, me and my friend watched the whole show, like jaws dropped, because basically Jay-Z and Beyonce were switching off songs. And every single one of Beyonce's songs was, he cheated on me, he did this to me, he loves me, he hates me, he does this. And the female empowerment songs were only empowering in the sense that like a guy had fucked her up and she was like stronger now because of it. That was all Beyonce's songs. And then they'd switch to Jay-Z and he'd be like, I'm the best, everything I do is the best, I'm rich, I'm sick, and there's bitches all around me. And that was like, you were seeing that back to back, and it was like, oh my God. And we're not flinching. No one in the audience is like, what the fuck? Everyone's like, yeah. So it's like. And so this is like, that moment was when I was like, holy shit. Like, this is like the culture. And if you're like, you clock it now, find a song that's playing on radio that a female is singing that's not about a dude and tell me about it, because it's so hard to find. And so I freaked out, and actually maybe that month I was working with one of my favorite people to write with is this girl, Britt Burton, and part of the reason is because it's like we can sit down and talk about what's going on and she can understand exactly what I'm feeling and I can understand what she's feeling, and we can write about it and it's comfortable. Not, and also Scott Harris is my favorite person to write with, so no disrespect to dudes. but we wrote a song called Masterpiece, which was then Jesse J's single, which was like, our goal was, let's write a female empowerment song that has nothing to do with a dude. And like, it was just the fact that that song did anything, and first of all, that it got through the gate with the entire staff of male A&Rs and all this stuff, like we knew it was gonna be, all right, if this song makes it, that's amazing. It's a major win if it even comes out. And then it got chosen to be the single, and it did its thing, and it was like amazing. And so then back to what I was saying at the beginning, that I won't say examples. There's a lot of songs on the radio where it's like, I actually cannot believe that is the lyric that like little girls all over the world are singing along to, and not even noticing what they're like. Mm. Sometimes you'll look at a song that you know all the words to, and you're being like, okay, hold on, what's this about? And it's like insane, and you didn't even know, and you're singing along. And that to me is like subliminal, crazy, perpetuating, not cool stuff. Mm. Mm. So 10 times out of 10, those songs are written by 6 dudes in a room, just saying what they think a girl would want to say. And it's not like they're trying to like degrade women. It's just like they're pretty sure that girls want to like go out and be sexy, and that's like their whole vibe. They just want everyone to like look at their body, and like that's it.
It's definitely what I want.
You know. So Yeah, I hope that answered your question.
Yeah, no, it absolutely does. And something that you said earlier too, yeah. Woo! Something that you said earlier as well, where, you know, you were astonished that it was able to make its way through the legion of male A&R people, mm-hmm. is another massive thing. You've got a huge audience of women, and you've got female songwriters, but essentially there are gatekeepers.
Right.
And those gatekeepers are men. And there's kind of also a great number of statistics that talks about the huge number of women who go into the music industry at entry level. Something like, I was reading a study earlier, the UK diversity study that was done last year. So it was, I guess, talking specifically about the English environment, but of all of the people who went into the music industry at an industry level, 57% of them were women between the ages of 25 and 35. But by the time you got to the next generational kind of area, the 35 to 45, moving up into the kind of ranks of the organisations, that number had dropped to 30%.
On the business side.
On the business side. And when you think about the kind of the business people who are making the major decisions about who gets signed, who gets promoted, and then who gets put out into the world backed by the kind of massive resources that are available, those decision makers are men. So have you struggled with that yourself? Like, do you find there's lots of interesting things to talk about with you as an artist as well, because you're both an artist and a writer, but have you found that as a writer there has been a I guess the best word is disadvantage about being female when the gatekeepers are men or not?
Mm-hmm. There's two answers to this question, because I think as a writer, I've benefited from being female, because there's so few, and so many female artists just wanna write with a girl, just wanna like spend the day in the room with a girl, and so that's been amazing. Like early on, I was literally getting gigs because it was like, oh, this person just has only been writing with dudes, and like you're the girl writer, so we'll put you guys together. As an artist, it's crazy because, I mean, do you guys all know this? Like, I mean, we were saying this just before, like if there's a band and it's four guys, it's a band. And if there's a band and it's four girls, it's a girl band. And same with like DJs, it's a DJ or it's a girl DJ. And so you're just, it's such a specific, you're not just an artist, it's like you're a girl artist. So you have to have a look and you have to have an outfit that you wear and your hair has to be colored and like all the shit. And it's like the amount of times I've even gone into meetings as a writer and heard what A&Rs are working on, and they're like, sign this guy, he's got a great voice, sign this girl, like she's really cute, let me show you a picture, like, and it's just it's like crazy. So that I feel a lot, and it's one of those things too where just the same with hearing crazy lyrics on the radio, like you don't flinch. I hear in a meeting, like A&R will really say back to back, this guy's a great voice and this girl's really cute, like you want to work with them. And so it's that's really hard. And just, yeah.
I was just taken back in time to a memory with my kids. I've got an older daughter and then younger twins. And my older daughter was walking around the house going, my anaconda don't, my anaconda don't want none. And then the twins went, unless you've got buns, huh? And I was like, okay, there is some really serious stuff.
Yeah.
Going on.
What are you guys saying right now?
That 6-year-old twins.
Yeah.
I really hope that they had no idea what they were saying.
Yeah. I remember going home and singing It Wasn't Me by Shaggy, top to bottom, to my mom, and her being like,
what?
What?
Oh, that's hilarious. I mean, so I read a really interesting statistic also quite recently, and that is, I'll just refer to my notes now to get it correct, 32 million people attend music festivals in the United States, and of those 32 million people, more than 50% are women. And yet, at Lollapalooza, 47 of the acts that play at that festival are mixed groups, so men and women, or female, and 124 are male exclusively. At Coachella, 60 of the acts are either mixed or female, 168 are exclusively male, and at the Ultra Festival, 20 female or mixed acts and 198 male acts. I can't believe that. I find that to be utterly insane. And not only that, but the kind of the whole kind of issue of sexual stereotypes and things like, you know, the guys who get on stage, there's a kind of a demeanor and a way that they present themselves and the lyrics and what you were saying and what their songs are about. You would not get a really feminine male artist like Prince coming out these days, because that kind of, I guess, ambiguous sexuality is not what people think about anymore. We've got really serious conditioning going on. You're an artist, you play, you have had great success in an ensemble with two other men in the Chainsmokers, right? So what have you come up against as an artist and in that environment where, in the festival environment and what you've witnessed around you in these places, what kind of barriers have you seen or experienced in that environment?
I guess, well, actually, I'm kind of, I did an artist thing I wrote for peers, and I'm just now coming back into doing my own artist stuff. And so I'm kind of coming at it new again. And I think I just had a conversation with someone recently where I was like, oh, you're so lucky. Like, even the Chainsmokers pretty much wear like white t-shirt, white pants, and that's like what they wear on stage, and it's cool they have a uniform. Whereas like every female artist is in like a different leotard situation every night and like, you know, legs and everything. And so that kind of stuff is really interesting. And even just like, I don't know, I think a lot about like how many male artists put out music without any image attached to it. And actually Lorde was the first person I remember seeing do that. First female I remember seeing do that. There was so much time where it was like, who is singing this? Like, what is this who does this look like? What is this? And that was such a cool way to like let the music speak for itself first. I think working with other male artists has been really, really cool for me, because I think men, for the most part, are really, especially if they're bringing me into the room with them, are really receptive to it. I think like there's something nice about like having a girl in a room. Like when I go in with the Chainsmokers, we sit down and it's like, what is going on with you guys? Like, what's up with your girlfriends? What's it like being a DJ with a girlfriend? Like, we talk and we talk and we talk and we talk, and every time now we go, they're like, oh god, like here we go again, another therapy session. But that's why they asked me back. So it's cool, and same with friendship. It's just been a really, like, I think they're really open to it. They're really cool with me. And honestly, like, I don't think, and like you said at the very beginning, like, I don't intensely think this is so male perpetuated. I don't think this is like men doing this, and certainly not intentionally. I think that there's like little stereotypes and little words we use and just things we say that kind of perpetuate this that aren't challenged. Like we were saying, girl band, girl DJ, girl producer. It's like, don't really let someone say that. Let's not call her a girl producer. She's a producer, just like he is. So it's these kind of things that are unchallenged. And I'm completely at fault to it too. I hear these things kind of in a meeting and I'm like, that sounded weird. And I don't say anything because, I don't know, I'm trying to get a cut. And you gotta do what you gotta do. No, just kidding.
There you go, golden rule number one.
No, I'm just kidding.
But you know, here's another statistic, just throwing these around wildly during the evening. Only 4% of producers in the US that are registered as producers are female. 4%. So if, you know, if there's an imbalance with songwriters, producers, engineers, you know, that's a really different statistic. Do you work with female producers? Are there any? Who do you collaborate? One,
Alex Hope. She's from Australia. She's amazing.
Right. So how different is that experience? And how do you know much about what her experience has been like in that environment and what her challenges have been?
Yeah, I mean, we've talked about it a few times. I think it's amazing. I mean, she's amazing because, like, she goes up against things like she'll send a final production and they'll be like, can you send the stems? Like, just assuming we're gonna get someone else in on this. And just like the things that you go up against, people thinking you're incompetent as a female producer, because who's a female producer? There's a cool thing with her, because her name's Alex, which is like kind of ambiguous, so sometimes it goes all the way to the finish line without anyone being like, a girl's doing it. But she's amazing, and it's funny. I vocal produce, and so I can get around on Pro Tools, which is very easy. If you are a female in here and you haven't tried it, like, it's not as hard as they make it seem. And every single time I've sat down and like done anything on Pro Tools, pretty much without fail, a guy's walked in the room and been like, Emily, you can use Pro Tools?
You can push the space button.
You can push the space button? And I'm always like, yes. Can we not make a scene right now? But it's funny. There is a funny thing when you see a girl doing it. It's like, even as a girl, you're like, oh, that's so cool. Like, sick. But it's, I don't know how we try to like get more used to seeing that. And it's just by, like, I think it's made to seem like making a beat is like really hard. And like, you really gotta like go through snare sounds, but like, it's just not that hard. Like, you just gotta do it. And I think actually, I found this because I went to a music school, and I found from the jump, all the guys would like hang out after class and go like share sounds with each other and make beats together. And all the girls were like off on their own. Like, guys are way more like, oh, come here, like, I'll show you how to make a beat. And I think...
Why do you think that is?
I don't know. This is something I think a lot about. I think, and I don't know why it is, but I find that girls can be really competitive with each other in a way that's, like, so unnecessary and detrimental. I mean, I found it a few times in sessions where, like, girls can be the weirdest about who's singing the demo. Like, I've been in a session before where someone's like, well, who's singing this? And I'm like, that's all good. Like, you can sing it, I can sing it, whatever. Like, it doesn't really, where you wouldn't do that with a guy, it's just like, I don't know. I don't really know what that is. I just find there's kind of like this tension that you have to break through. It's like, okay, we're not competing. Like, we're both in this room. I've actually had like a couple of female writers say that they won't work with me because we're both female writers and we're both the same age, and like, why would we do that? And it's like,
wow.
Maybe because we're different people that write songs. So yeah, there's that, and I kind of think that it's because that it has something to do with that we are compared a lot in society. Like Demi Lovato and Selena Gomez are constantly being compared, and it's like, I always find that so strange. Like, even Billboard will post articles like, Demi versus Selena, like, who does this better? And it's like, what do these two have in common? Like, they're female humans, like, and they're brunette. Like, why are we comparing their lyrics? And I think, like, I get it, like, whenever I play my music for people, you always hear, oh, this reminds me of Sarah Bareilles, or oh, this reminds me of Adele, like, just because I'm a girl who's singing and like play an instrument. So there's a lot of like putting people in comparison that I think just kind of like trickles down.
So then what do we do? Especially those of us who are young women who, like myself, who are venturing in to the music industry. Sorry. Young women who are venturing into this environment, what do we do? What's your advice? Because I know that you're 24 years old and you seem such an ancient soul in a 24-year-old kind of vessel. And the maturity that with which you're talking, I know plenty of people who are 24 stepping into the music industry, and it's hard to muster that confidence. It's hard to muster that sense of self-determination, especially when you're about to put your soul on the line, you know, the things that you make, the things that you care about, all of the things that you talk about, what you pour out of your heart and hand it to somebody on a plate and say, what do you think? Is this worth anything? And does anybody want to listen to it? Mm-hmm. What's your advice for young women in that situation, so vulnerable, often naive, going into that kind of environment?
I think you got to start with yourself and know, first of all, that like it doesn't matter that you're a girl. It doesn't matter. Like, I never felt like I needed to dress a certain way or show up a certain way and talk a certain way in order to get in a session. And I think if you just set that standard for yourself, you don't have to do it. If someone expects that of you, then that's not a good session anyways. So, and that's not someone you want to be around. So I think you start with yourself. You know, also, like, I grew up with three brothers, so, like, I don't have any sisters, and I just never seen any girl as, like, competition at all. Like, I don't think it's good to address anything, not even just a girl, but anyone in the room. If you're in a session, you're there because, or if you're writing, or someone wants to hear your music, or someone's going to take a second to listen to your music, they're doing it because they're interested in you, not your hairstyle. Like, that's just irrelevant. So just, like, to have confidence in what you can do regardless of anything else. Mm. And yeah, I guess, like, just, I think sometimes as a female you feel like you'll do things that you're uncomfortable with because you have to, and I just think that's totally wrong. That you should feel comfortable all the time. And like I said, like, an opportunity that you miss because they expect you to do something else is not really a missed opportunity. It's a waste of time anyways. So, and I think ultimately people take you more seriously if you take yourself seriously. Mm. So mm. I think just, yeah, that your gender shouldn't alter any of that.
Yeah, I'm very much of the belief that gender inequality is not a female problem, it's just a human problem.
Right.
And to that human problem, there's a human solution. So it's not women who have to kind of solve that problem or men who have to solve that problem. It's all of us, you know, that we kind of look at each other and we understand that these things, you know, affect all of us, and especially with a musical language, you know, we're speaking to each other in a really, as you say, a really true way. So then, if we're kind of all responsible for the solution to this, what would your advice be then to young men going into the music industry, or even to more established or older men in the music industry?
A lot of the same, and then I think also just, I wish that some of the men A&Rs that I met with didn't say things like, look at this artist, look how she looks, and stuff like that, and weigh so heavily on that. I think that's not even like a music industry thing, that's like the world and society in general. And it sucks knowing that people are really valuing you on how you look and things that have nothing to do with why you're there in the first place. Or that you're a girl, or that you're a girl producer, or anything, that it's not like a better record because a girl produced it, but like it should have the same shot as anyone else. I think that's what all of us just want, just an equal playing field and just the same opportunities. And I think I've been really, really lucky that all the guys I work with are not like that. I mean, Zach, my manager, is like my best friend and understands all this and agrees and fights for it also. So it's like, just, yeah, hell yeah.
Yeah.
He's the best. But yeah, I think this is like a team effort thing. And I think if everybody is just respects everyone else at the same level and takes everybody seriously in the same way, then this can be less of a problem.
Do you crave a sisterhood in the work that you do? Like, because the other thing is that you travel a lot. So you spend a lot of time in LA, then you go to New York, then you go to London. So you're constantly moving from place to place. And that must be, for anybody, a dislocating thing to do. Do you crave a sisterhood in the work that you do?
I don't know. I don't know if I've thought about that. I think, like I said, I have three brothers, and so I've just been really accustomed to, like, hanging out with dudes. And I think, like, because we were also talking about this just before we came out here, I worked with Chelsea and Echo. We had a session. Like, they came up to me after the first day, and we're like, let's just get the three of us girls in a room together with Sam, who's here. I know he's here. And to put up with us all day. But it was just, like, I could tell that they felt comforted, and I could tell that it was just like, all right, suddenly there's just like a different, more chill vibe in here, which is for whatever reason. And then it was just like a really interesting, cool day because we were just talking. We actually ended up writing a song about this, basically.
And that was fascinating, actually, because I had been wandering from room to room, popping my head in the door and kind of getting a sense of what the energy was in each room. And there was lots of really bouncy, fun, kind of ebullient energy in all of the rooms, which is not to say that you guys didn't have that in your room, but when, and it also could just be that the moment that I popped my head in the door was different. But what you guys had was a really kind of quiet, focused, really intense vibe in there. You know, you were talking, you were thinking,
right.
It was very quiet. Is that what it's normally like?
I think it's definitely fun, but for me it's like, and this is just based on my personal taste, like I'd love to just sit and talk about stuff and like learn things through talking and then put what we've learned into a song. So we were really like, the actual songwriting was maybe like 10, 15, 20 minutes, and the rest was just like talking and talking and talking about like what it's like being a girl and what it's like helping, like literally this conversation pretty much, which is amazing because you leave a session not just having a song done, but having talked to interesting, cool people all day and learning a lot from them and about them and yourself and everything. So that's like, I think, because you said before, like I love to travel, and part of what I love so much about it is like there's so many people on this planet coming from such different places, and it's so interesting to me to like like all of us in this room are coming from such different places, and it's so interesting to hear and just understand that. And so music is the coolest way ever to do that, because you could go as a tourist and not meet anyone, or you could go as a writer and like literally get set up on playdates every day and like hang out with different people every day.
But, you know, what's so fascinating about what you do, and like I was thinking about the room that you were in with Sam and Chelsea and Eka, is that essentially each day you're thrown into a room with strangers, and all of you in that room yesterday were essentially strangers to each other, and then you had to kind of, over the period of maybe 7 hours, would have been the maximum amount of time. For those of you who don't know how Songhubs work, we gather all of these people together. There are 5 writing rooms, and Greg, who curates it all and who has picked all of the people who are taking part, makes a list of who is going to be writing together in each room. They don't choose each other. He kind of imagines what the chemistry might be like. He takes into account what people have said and who they're drawn to, but he makes a list, and they arrive at 10 o'clock in the morning, and off they go, and they sit down and they start writing a song, and by the end of the day, there is a song. And so, and you do this for a living, so you go from country to country and you step into rooms with strangers all the time, and then you start creating intimate, truthful music. How on earth?
I love doing it so much. I think initially I was so surprised by how ready artists and other writers were to just like talk about whatever was going on. Like, you can imagine what a relief it must be to be in a room and have someone be like, what is in your head? What's scaring you? What are you nervous about? What are you feeling really good about? Like, everyone has something. Something is in your head that like is bugging you before you go to sleep or whenever. And so it's just so cool how quickly, I mean, people are always like, how do you get so close to a stranger? So like, you literally meet someone and then 2 seconds later you're talking about like deep secrets that they've never told anyone else, and it's like people want that. People want to just talk and be heard, and I think even now more than ever, especially when people aren't listening and people are on their phones and like conversations are hard, to have someone just be like, talk to me, what do you want to talk about? And it's just like, oh, thank you. Everything.
Yeah.
So it's cool, and it's so rewarding for me to start the session, know someone has something in their head, and then by the end of the day have helped release it a little bit and turn it into something that they can, that's 2-3 minutes long, that they can listen to and comfort themselves with. That is like the coolest thing ever to me.
So for, like I was saying earlier when I introduced you, we are very much, I hope I can speak for all of us without sounding like I'm making dreadful generalizations on behalf of everybody, but we're essentially a culture of people that like to do things ourselves. Is that fair to say?
I've been hearing about that.
Yeah. And you might have even found that so far in your experience here.
Yeah.
So for those of us who hold on to our ideas and are protective of them and who feel like it's a very big ask to relinquish our identity in a collaborative situation, what's your advice in terms of opening out and accepting and exchanging ideas with other writers when it feels so kind of fiercely personal?
I think it's funny because I was saying earlier, like, this is the school of thought that I come from that was like, I'm not ever gonna write a song in front of someone else. This is like my diary. I can't do that with someone else in the room. To then realizing that, like, songwriting is not you going in a room with someone who wants to, like, change you and tell you what to say and, like, change, you're suddenly like a robot that's speaking their lyrics. If you're with someone that's good and cares, I think that the session should be like, it's like when you sit down and have a conversation with anyone, you both kind of like add to what you're talking about, you both learn from each other, you either change your opinion or you don't. And I think a session is largely the same way. If someone wants to help you say something and you don't agree, then you don't have to agree and it's fine. But to me, collaboration is not what I originally thought it was, which is like, this is gonna ruin my pure, like, me, Emily Warren songwriting thing. It's way more like, what can another person in the room enhance? What I can just like think of one thing that's a kernel of an idea and they can bring it to the next step and then I can take it to the next step, and through conversation we can kind of like meet not only in the middle of what we're thinking but in a place that's more maybe universal, even, because at least two people have felt that, at least two people agree on that. So I totally get it. I think it's scary. I think my first few sessions, especially the very first one, were like train wrecks, and I was shy and scared, and like, how do you have the confidence to even suggest a lyric or a melody or anything when someone else is sitting there and they might have a better lyric? It's like, as soon as you get that out of your head and just think, okay, I have a thing that I do that's really good, like, and I like it, so I'm gonna bring that to this session, not with that person. I actually like, one more thing on that. One of the best pieces of advice I was ever given was, that's a big statement, but I mean, I'm signed to Dr. Luke, and I was going to work with him for the first time, and I was driving out to his house in Malibu, and I had signed to him a while before and met him a few times, but it was like, this was like a really big deal, and weeks in advance, they're like, move this session, Luke wants to work with you, and it was like, ugh. And my publisher, who signed me to him, called me on the way there, and she was like, I just want to remind you, Luke is not having you over there to write a Luke song. He's having you over there to write an Emily Warren song. He's brought you here because he likes what you do. And I was literally like, but like, it makes so much sense when you think about it. And if you can kind of keep that in your head and not let, no one's trying to like, I mean, ideally, no one's really trying to like turn you into something. They're just trying to like cultivate what you have. So if you keep that in mind, it's easier to open up to working with other people.
I'm sure that we've got some time for people's questions if anybody would like to ask Emily anything.
Da, da, da.
Kieran, hello.
Hello, how are
you? Very well, thank you.
I'm just curious, you've been songwriting for the last little while, and you just started writing your own songs for your own artist career, and how have you found, like, all of everything aside, coming back to your own space, writing for yourself, and pursuing your own career? Has that been, like, a challenge, or just something you've sunk into easily, or, how's that process been?
It's been amazing, actually. I mean, what kind of started it was the song Capsize I did with Friendship, and I always had the artist bug in me. I think I kind of was just saying that I didn't want to be an artist because it was way easier at the time to get into rooms with other artists if there wasn't that. If I was just like, no, I'm just writing, like, don't worry about it. There were songs along the way that I wrote, in particular with Scott, when it was just me and him on guitar, and I'd be like, oh, can we just write about this thing that I'm thinking about, that someone could cut them, and I'd be like, I don't think someone should cut that. Like, I can't give that song away. And once we had a collection of those and my voice was on something that people were reacting to, it was kind of like, all right, I don't know why I'm saying I'm not an artist. I feel like an art. I feel like I want to put songs out that I'm singing on, at least. So then reverting back, because I got so comfortable with getting in the room and being like, how do you feel? To then getting in the room and someone being like, how do you feel? And I was like, was like challenging at first and then amazing. Like, just so, I think I spent the years between when I was doing it then and now really learning how to write a song, really learning how to express ideas. And then when it came to my own ideas, it's just been like such a treat. I wasn't ready then, honestly. Like, I think there were things that were good, but now it's like, I know when I sit down, I can like express what I'm talking about really clearly. And so that's just been like amazing. I think one of the main criticisms of my band, when I had a band, was like, they'd be like, you have a reggae song and then a pop song and then a rock song. Like, what are you guys doing? And now it's like, it's so clear to me what I want it to sound like and what I want it to be. So that's what the transition's been.
Yes.
I have a kind of tag question.
Yeah.
Karen's question and then I have my own question.
Okay.
My tag question.
Only
is,
one.
Do you now co-write for your own music as your own artist? And then my question is, do you ever have sessions where you get stuck or you hit a wall and or you feel like you personally at least can't kind of contribute, and if so, what do you do to push past that?
Okay, so the first question, yes, another great thing about having spent this time just working with everyone is I know exactly what I want to do with now. So I have like Scott Harris and Britt, who are my favorite to write with, and then like two producers that over the course of time showed interest in working on my stuff and like I know I work well with. So yes. And then getting stuck in a session, yeah, that happens a lot. My thing is I'm doing this job because it's fun, you know? Like, there's way more lucrative, not fun jobs if you want to do that. But, like, this I'm doing because I enjoy writing songs. And so when I get stuck and I kind of feel like, okay, this isn't going anywhere, or, like, we could get through and just, like, finish this song, but, like, I'm not really feeling it, that to me, I've started to try to avoid. If you get stuck, start a new song, or, like, go out and get lunch, come back. It shouldn't ever really feel like, why can't I get this lyric? If that's happening, then something's wrong. And it's totally normal to get stuck, but to not feel like it's flowing and like you're moving forward, that's when you need to just like take a break or switch it up or something, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Hey. I'm really curious about that process in the moment. And so, at which point do you go out to go blah, 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 blah? You go, okay, right, let's get a bass, or let's get down to
it's always different. I think sometimes you need a track to get inspired, sometimes you need to hear a beat, sometimes it's a lyric, sometimes you hear a lyric over a melody in your head. I think whatever way it comes is the way. I think as long as you feel like there's something that you want to like help fill the parts around that you want to follow, then you're in a good spot. But I don't think there's any like right or wrong order at all.
Yes, I can see somebody from behind there. Yeah.
I'm just wondering, outside the writing sessions, do you do anything to improve your craft by yourself?
Mm. Yeah, I mean, I think actually, it's funny you say that. I was just having this conversation with my friend. The coolest part about writing songs is that everything you do outside of writing songs is enhancing writing songs. So like you could be walking down the street and like see, you don't even have to be looking for it, but just living and experiencing and talking to people all enhance how you think and therefore enhance how you write. So I think I love walking, I love talking to people, I love like going to museums, I just love like taking in stuff, and not because I'm like, oh, I'm going to get a song lyric today, but just because I think living and also not pressuring yourself to be working all the time and not writing all the time, but knowing that not working is working. And that's what's sick about this job. yeah, definitely. Everything. I think everything is good. And everything, if something's making you think or someone's making you think, that's good.
I'm curious to know whether or not concentrating so much on the craft of songwriting affects how you hear songs and listen to songs by other people, and whether or not you're ever able to enjoy a song now without taking it apart in your mind and breaking it down into its constituent parts and then putting it back together again critically.
Yeah, I mean, that's really hard. I think if you hear a song that's amazing, you're kind of like, why is this amazing? What did they do that's amazing? I think when I listen to music and I don't think about that, that's when I'm like, this is amazing. but honestly, that for me is like, is older stuff that I grew up on. It's really hard now to like, we were driving today and one of my friends wrote on the new Dua Lipa Martin Garrix song, and it came on and
Zach was like, do you like this song? And I was like, I honestly haven't like listened to it and thought about that. I've just been like, oh, Nate wrote this. And like, when you know too much, it's definitely hard to enjoy. But I think I've at least convinced myself that there's nothing wrong with that. If you're really analyzing a song's lyrics because that's what you do and that's what you love to do, then it's okay.
What happens when someone you love writes a song you hate?
You say, that's really good, I love you.
I guess, what else is there to say?
Nothing.
But if there's somebody that you trust and somebody that you collaborate with and you're honest with each other, if somebody like that writes a song and you're not sure about it, would you say?
I'm really bad with that. I think... just because I know what it, like, I just kind of like picked the first song that I'm gonna put out and I sent it to all my brothers and they all sent like five paragraphs of like, you should sing this like this. And I was like, I actually just wanted you guys to tell me you loved it. So thank you for your comments. when you make something, it's like, it's your baby and especially if it's already out in the world, you don't want to hear that people don't like it. And that's why you don't read YouTube comments.
Any other questions? Yeah.
I read an interview with you somewhere where you talked about writing songs and the position you're in as a writer to create songs that will have like a socially positive impact on the world. And I was just wondering if you could talk about how that's applied to the songs you've written. If you have any examples of where you feel like that's actually been a thing and you've been able to get a good message out there and how that impacts you on day-to-day.
Yeah, it's a really good question because this is something, especially now, that I can't really get out of my head when I'm in a session. I think as writers, we have a responsibility to be addressing what's going on. I'm sort of still figuring it out. I think directly addressing some of this stuff and doing it in a way that doesn't sound like preachy or like you know better is really a hard thing, that's like literally what I'm trying to do right now, is figure out how to do that. I don't know if I can like tell you a song that I've done that I'm like, okay, this is really like what I want to say, but I think, and that's not true. I guess what I'm trying to say is, I'm really trying to not put anything bad out there, not anything that I don't think is a good thing for people to hear. And actually, I have a song that I'm singing on called Phone Down that just came, like, I guess it came out a while ago now, but I insisted on staying on the song because it was like, that is something that's so important to me, is communication, and when I'm talking to someone, they take their phone out, I feel like I've been stabbed in the heart. And it was like, when this was being discussed, who was gonna sing it, I was like, I have to, like, if there's something I have to say to planet Earth right now, it's this. Like, I feel really strongly about it. And so, like, I had a session a while ago now, it was maybe a couple months ago, where I was like, what's going on with you, to the artist? And she was like, I got in a huge fight with my boyfriend last night. We couldn't agree on what to order for dinner. And I was like, I'm not writing about that. We cannot spend this day writing about that. And so then it's just like, I don't know yet, or maybe I never will, how to like put exactly what you want to say out into the universe. I just know that I'm trying to not say things that I wouldn't want to say or that I wouldn't want to hear. And I think what I found is, as the closest thing to, I keep thinking that this time is so reminiscent of the 60s. And I just saw an exhibit in London about music in the 60s, and what blew my mind was songs were only coming out and only being listened to if they were about what was going on. Like, that's why music existed, not because like the Beatles wanted to be celebrities. It was like, we're gonna talk about the war and we're gonna address it, and that's why people need music. And for a while we've gotten really far away from that. Like, it has been about celebrity. Like, you're giving a song to an artist because they're like paid to be famous, you know, and not because they're like, I feel really strongly about this, this, and this, and that's what I want my songs to be about. So it's turning now, I really think. And I think what's been amazing on the writer side is, it's not good enough if like the beat is amazing and the melodies are sick. Like, the song has to be good now. It has to be like actually saying something for it to make it, you know? So it's awesome. And I think if we all just like continue to challenge each other and continue to have to react to what's going on radio and on Spotify and everything, it's like more and more you need to have meaning. You need to be addressing at least how you feel about anything, you know? So. Mm.
Mm. Yes.
Yeah, I am. It's a really good question because we were talking about this in our session the other day, actually. Which is, and first of all, I want to preface this by saying this is my own opinion and my own way of writing. But when I was in middle school, I learned how to write, and I guess we were talking about this. They don't teach this here, but in America, they teach you the 5-paragraph essay, which is an intro and 3 body paragraphs, and then a conclusion. And the intro has in it the thesis statement, which your whole essay has to. You did that?
No.
All right. You didn't do that.
Were you paying attention, Chelsea?
Okay, so you guys know this structure, which I then got to college and they were like, forget everything you learned. But what I learned from that, I think, is like, if you're writing a song, each section is an opportunity to prove a point, which to me is the title or the chorus, or at least like part of the chorus, which is like, you decide you're gonna write a song about whatever it is. And then verse one is one angle to come at that. It's like one view of it, and then ideally in verse two it's like, okay, well, here's another way to look at the situation and still come back to the same chorus, and then the bridge is like the crazy plot twist. It's like, how could you even say that in this song? No one even made it this far, but they did, and now they're hearing this crazy other side. So to me, that's actually why I love talking so much at the beginning of the session, because I want to figure out, what are we writing about, what really specific thing are we trying to communicate in this song? And then now that we've spoken for 5 hours, we have all these real life examples of how you get there. So, and again, this is my thing. Like, I love storytelling in song. So if you're telling a story, then it's like, here's the point. Here's all the different ways to get to it. So I think in order for it to be easy, you do have to kind of pick, what am I talking about? What specific thing am I trying to say? And then everything else kind of like should fit in around it easily. Mm. Yeah.
Oh, sorry, H. There was somebody just down the back, and then you.
That's a good question, and something, I mean, to me, the song is like what you can sit down at the piano and play. And I think there's a lot of, especially like working with like DJs like the Chainsmokers and stuff, where it's very track heavy and the track is really important. I think to challenge yourself to think, okay, if I sat down and played this on piano, it didn't have the drop, would this still be a good song? And if it is still a good song, then like that rules, because then you also get the drop, and that's great. But I think if you, and this is another thing, like I don't love doing like a million vocals. Like I don't love doing doubles and harmonies and all this stuff, because I often feel like people want to do that because like the chorus isn't good enough. So maybe if we put a harmony on it, like it will sound bigger. I think if it sounds good without that and you add it just to like add textures, that's cool. But I think to challenge yourself that, how does this sound just me playing it on guitar or piano or whatever? Is this a good song? And then the rest can kind of enhance it.
Mm. Age.
My question was, for those of us in the room who don't get to hang out with Luke or the need to make some scenarios that you're writing, do you reckon that it's like the more songwriting technique you can learn from all the books that you can soak up, the better, and just go for all that learning and that kind of intellect side that's in the process, like how to or that can be a danger, you know, turn up to that and you want to be just going for more the kind of feel of what you're saying, where you want the point of the song and you want to kind of give an angle, like, do you know what I mean? Like,
uh-huh.
How much of it is the feel and how much of it is the technique? You really want to know?
I think it's like 99.9% feel. And I think there's things, there's rules that you can learn, that you can think about, like, and actually before I signed to Luke or anything, I remember I made, and I still have them, these playlists on Spotify that were like, I found out who wrote what song, and then I put a playlist together of all the songs I'd written. And not really, like, don't spook yourself and be like, I gotta write like Benny Blanco or else I suck, but just like, what are these guys, what tricks are all these writers using to make the chorus sound like a chorus, to make the chorus something that I really want to sing along to. And then to like learn that but not have it wreck what you're writing is challenging, but kind of like to get in it and then put it on the back burner and be like, all right, what's my thing? I think you have something to teach people also. You have your own unique way of writing, and I think anyone you write with has that. So just like listen, the music that you love has the answers in it too. Like, why do you love a song? What about that song do you love? For me, it's always the story and the lyrics, and so that's what I'm trying to do.
It's interesting because it's like that idea that the rules that you might break then create the new rules that everybody else wants to follow.
Yeah. Actually, that's what's been so interesting about the Chainsmokers to me, is like before them in sessions, it was like you'd pick a phrase and you'd repeat it four times and that was the chorus. And Drew and Drew's choruses are like run-on sentences. Like, Closer is like, you have to listen to that song 100 times before you know what the chorus is, but somehow it's still really catchy. And if I suggested that chorus in a session before that song came out, people would be like, that's not a chorus, that's a paragraph. You need to pick one thing to say from that. And so they've totally broken that. So then again, like, there's no rules at all. But yeah, like you can kind of see what people like, people do that you like, and then kind of know that it doesn't matter.
Even though it feels like this has all happened in about 20 seconds, we've only got time for a couple more questions. So I now call on the last one or two people.
Is there an escape clause when you go into a writing session? If partway through, it's turning into a song, it's probably going to be a hit. But you're like, oh my God, I do not want my name. You know, like, if you want to write a song called Give Peace a Chance.
Yeah.
And towards the end, the artist is like really excited that it's going to be called Give Trump a Chance.
Yeah.
Depends on your politics, Mark.
I mean, to be totally honest, like, I've been involved in some things I'm like not proud of for pretty much that reason. But I think for me, the artist always comes first. And so what they want to say, what they're comfortable saying, has to be the first thing, even if I don't agree with it. I guess the trick is like finding out if it's something they actually want to say or if they feel pressured to say it. And that's where I would come in and interfere. But otherwise, like, if they want to sing about Trump, then I think I'd probably put a fake name on it.
One more. Anyone? Yeah. You were first. Okay, we can have two more.
Just expanding on that thing, I think we're out here in New Zealand. Looking back at America, it seems like the music industry really is often divided along political lines so much. And how much is that a reality with the experience that
What do you mean divided? That?
Well, that people really have to show their allegiances.
Yeah.
Working within the industry, and that there are, I mean, we see that the media right now is very much red or blue.
Right.
In lots of ways. Is it the same experience in music parts of the music industry when you're getting up there?
Yeah, and that's actually like, that's why I think so many artists are scared to say things that they want to say, because someone could catch a soundbite of you having a conversation with someone and suddenly it's like a headline somewhere and it's been twisted in a million ways and that's not what you said at all. And like, it's just, I think it's really hard. And I think as an artist, it's kind of like more than ever, it's like, all right, if I say this, am I ruining everything? Is this a thing worth saying, even though it's what I believe in? And I think that's a really, really fine line. And I think, I mean, you have to be comfortable saying what you're saying, but it is too bad that there's that much pressure that it's like you have to really decide, am I going to be outspoken or not, because I could lose it all and then have no one listening to me and then it doesn't matter what I say. But do you guys know about the Dixie Chicks thing?
That's
like
that's
that.
Really what I was saying.
Yeah.
The experience they went through, it's like, man, that
literally getting death threats. And they didn't even say anything that intense. It was like kind of a side remark that just got totally blown. But I mean, to me, that's amazing that they did that. Like, that is very admirable and just like incredible that they did that.
For those of us who don't know, what did they do?
I think they said it was when George Bush was president, and they said, we're embarrassed to be from a place where our president's from. I think that that's what they said.
Right.
And obviously they're like, the people that are their fans are like pretty much just Republicans. So it was like this huge outrage. Mm. And they were literally getting death threats and like, you know, would have to go play shows knowing that people actually wanted them dead because they said that.
Yeah.
Well, speaking out against the Gulf War, I think it was like,
Yeah. We've just got time for one more question now.
No, I'm not. But I get that a lot.
It's been so wonderful to hear what you have to say and to kind of have your career and your process and your experience illuminated for us. We're so grateful. Thank you very, very much
for coming. I really appreciate it. Guys, but it's way cooler that I'm in New Zealand writing songs right now and talking to you guys. So, seriously, thank you so much.
A
have
pleasure.
A good night.
Yay.